very cool. Max Dean's chair is one way to express your artistic vision in a kind of futuristic way. But the people in our next story have an artistic vision that also relies on latest technology. The only difference is it's as far from the future as you can get.
I always like to kind of consider it a bit of time travel. You're trying to recreate something that you think happened or something that existed tens of millions of years ago.
Brian Cooley brings dinosaurs to life. He's a dinosaur sculptor with a worldwide reputation.
We've got dinosaurs in Japan. We sent one over to Spain, Taiwan, many museums in the U.S.
I think what we'll do is we'll raise it with forks. It'll take some slack, but it's going to be a while before it's closed off balance. And I think I'll be able to.
He and his team are now working on a truly massive project. They're creating not one, but four dinosaurs for a brand new display at the Royal Tyrrell Museum of Paleontology in Drumheller, Alberta.
It's way more fun if you can have a group of dinosaurs interacting. And so I'm always much more excited about projects like the one I'm working on now, where you have more than one individual.
They're working on Cooley's specialty, the Albertosaurus.
The Albertosaurus looks like a slender, more graceful version of the Tyrannosaurus Rex, except when they've reached full adult size.
Adult Albertosauruses could equal the T-Rex, stretching up to 11 meters or 36 feet in length. The team is building a scene based on a real-life event, a catastrophic flood that wiped out many dinosaurs, and Albertosauruses in particular, in prehistoric Alberta.
In fact, all the dinosaurs in general in Alberta, we find because they were killed in catastrophic events like hurricanes and floods, and they got buried.
But those very disasters preserve bones, bones paleontologists use to reconstruct skeletons.
What we're going to do now is get eyes.
But Cooley builds his dinosaurs from scratch, creating them not from bones, but styrofoam, putty, and painstaking research.
What I'm doing right now is I'm placing the eyes in their sockets and trying to get them positioned, located where they would be, and then get them focused on a point like they would in real life.
He and his wife, Mary Ann Wilson, have been making dinosaurs ever since they graduated from art school together 25 years ago.
I might need some pliers, please.
You need pliers?
Yeah.
There's a lot to talk about when you run your own business. And so we do end up talking and thinking quite a bit about dinosaurs.
One of the things they talk about is how things have changed. Just as the dinosaurs evolved, so has our understanding of the creatures.
It was becoming popular belief around the time we started making dinosaurs that they were warm-blooded and they were more agile and faster moving, and that they were also gregarious and lived in groups and herds. It's one of the biggest, the most shocking changes that's taken place in our understanding of dinosaurs since we started making them, is the fact that a great number of dinosaurs were covered with feathers, not lizard-like skin.
Another thing that's changed, how Cooley works. It still starts with scientific approval for his miniature models or maquettes, like this one.
The maquette actually takes quite a while because that includes all my research time where I measure the skeletons and talk to the paleontologists and also reference the anatomy of living creatures so that I can determine what kind of musculature these dinosaurs might have had and what that musculature would have.
I always like to kind of consider it a bit of time travel. You're trying to recreate something that you think happened or something that existed tens of millions of years ago.
Brian Cooley brings dinosaurs to life. He's a dinosaur sculptor with a worldwide reputation.
We've got dinosaurs in Japan. We sent one over to Spain, Taiwan, many museums in the U.S.
I think what we'll do is we'll raise it with forks. It'll take some slack, but it's going to be a while before it's closed off balance. And I think I'll be able to.
He and his team are now working on a truly massive project. They're creating not one, but four dinosaurs for a brand new display at the Royal Tyrrell Museum of Paleontology in Drumheller, Alberta.
It's way more fun if you can have a group of dinosaurs interacting, and so I'm always much more excited about projects like the one I'm working on now, where you have more than one individual.
They're working on Cooley's specialty, the Albertosaurus.
The Albertosaurus looks like a slender, more graceful version of the Tyrannosaurus Rex, except when they've reached full adult size.
Adult Albertosauruses could equal the T-Rex, stretching up to 11 meters or 36 feet in length. The team is building a scene based on a real-life event, a catastrophic flood that wiped out many dinosaurs, and Albertosauruses in particular, in prehistoric Alberta.
In fact, all the dinosaurs in general in Alberta, we find because they were killed in catastrophic events like hurricanes and floods, and they got buried.
But those very disasters preserve bones, bones paleontologists use to reconstruct skeletons.
What we're going to do now is get eyes.
But Cooley builds his dinosaurs from scratch, creating them not from bones, but styrofoam, putty, and painstaking research.
What I'm doing right now is I'm placing the eyes in their sockets and trying to get them positioned, located where they would be, and then get them focused on a point like they would in real life.
He and his wife, Mary Ann Wilson, have been making dinosaurs ever since they graduated from art school together 25 years ago.
I need some pliers, please.
You need pliers?
Yeah.
There's a lot to talk about when you run your own business. And so we do end up talking and thinking quite a bit about dinosaurs.
One of the things they talk about is how things have changed. Just as the dinosaurs evolved, so has our understanding of the creatures.
It was becoming popular belief around the time we started making dinosaurs that they were warm-blooded and they were more agile and faster moving, and that they were also gregarious and lived in groups and herds. It's one of the biggest, the most shocking changes that's taken place in our understanding of dinosaurs since we started making them, is the fact that a great number of dinosaurs were covered with feathers, not lizard-like skin.
Another thing that's changed, how Cooley works. It still starts with scientific approval for his miniature models or maquettes, like this one.
The maquette actually takes quite a while because that includes all my research time where I measure the skeletons and talk to the paleontologists and also reference the anatomy of living creatures so that I can determine what kind of musculature these dinosaurs might have had and what that musculature would have looked like.
But where he once went through multiple steps, constructing steel skeletons and rubber molds to develop a finished fiberglass dinosaur, now technology is taking over.
As time goes on, the body becomes less and less willing to do all that work. Over the last decade or so, there's been an advance in the three-dimensional scanning of objects.
Cooley has handed over the heavy jobs to a Calgary company named, appropriately, Heavy Industries. They do 3D laser scans of his models. Automated cutting machines carve full-scale pieces out of styrofoam. Thanks to the laser scanning, the pieces match the contours of the miniature exactly. But that means Cooley has to be more exact at the front end of the process when he makes his model.
If, for example, I'm in the course of making the maquette, I make one of the toes or one of the fingers a couple of millimeters too long or too short, it doesn't seem like any big deal. But as you you know, blow it up 10 times, if you're out a little ways, suddenly it starts to look a little goofy once you've got it into life size.
Heavy Industries assembles the pieces onto a steel armature and hands the completed structure over for finishing touches. But finishing touches can take months when you're dealing with such a big project. The team creates skin from epoxy putty, adding texture with a skin mold. Everything has to be just right, including the temperature, for it all to work.
One of the challenges this year has been just the heat of the summer. It causes the materials to behave somewhat differently than what we would like them to. They definitely are easier to work with at cooler temperatures.
After the epoxy putty hardens, it's painted for heightened realism. And that's when Cooley's team gets the payoff.
I think probably the greatest pleasure is watching something evolve from nothing into an increasingly more complete and vivid sculpture.
And speaking of understanding the distant past better, little Lucy.